printed for you in your bulletin. So let us stand together and join in singing Sanctuary. We will sing this through twice.
Oh, every day of our lives. We have been richly fed with good food and homes, with education and work, and with so many things we take for granted. Feed us now with your glorious presence and with your word that humbles us. Lift us up so that we may glorify you and do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. As we turn our hearts to prayer this morning, we want to close on our lengthy prayer list and those concerns that you hold in your heart today, those things that are known only to the Lord, but we bring those before our Lord as well. As we turn our hearts to prayer, we want to use the prayer chorus that is printed for you in your bulletin that we've been using for the last several weeks. Not my will, but thine be done. Coordinating action and
guide the work of recovery. Lord, we ask that by the strength of your Spirit, that you would guide and direct us in how to respond to all the needs that are around us. Give us your grace and your compassion to reach out in love as we are able, to help alleviate the suffering of those in need. Lord, you call us by your grace to take up our own cross and to follow you. And it takes us a lifetime to discover what that means as we daily offer ourselves unto you. May your Spirit give us grace and strength as we seek to follow you in all things. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, we pray. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 9 through 14. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. Epistle lesson comes from the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let's admonish one another with wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Well, today marks the last Sunday of having a special time in worship for singing our favorites, and we appreciate all those who submitted your favorite hymns to us. I think we got to most of them, but if we did not, we'll work them into the service for the next couple of months, but we do appreciate your hymn requests. We did get a couple of hymn requests that specifically related to work, had something to do with work. So I decided we would save those for the weekend that we were honoring the American workforce. And those hymns are in the hymn insert that is in your bulletin today. So these are the hymn requests that we will sing together. We will start with We'll Work Till Jesus Comes. The choir didn't know this one, but it's somebody's favorite, so I hope you're here today if this is your favorite. We'll Work Till Jesus Comes. We'll sing verses 1 and 3.
Oh,
we'll sing verses 1 and 3 of Work, For the Night Is Coming. The gifts and skills with which God has blessed us. When we were young, many of us knew from an early age what we wanted to be when we grew up. For others, it took a good bit of time and exploration to figure that all out. God has blessed us with natural inclinations and personalities that might suit us better to a particular kind of work, to another. In the past, as we know, especially in Jesus' time, most young boys learned the family trade, or they became an apprentice to learn a trade, a job that they would keep for their entire lives. For women, in the past, our primary vocational choice revolved around the nurturing and care of children and the home. But as we know today, the options and the possibilities are endless. I think I've shared before, but I will never forget when our oldest daughter, Lydia, was in high school. We spent some time visiting some potential colleges that she was interested in. And I was so surprised at one of these gatherings before the campus tour, when the dean of admissions was talking to the prospective students and parents. And he said how the job market is now changing so quickly that labor statistics project that young people who are entering the workforce today can expect to change careers an average of 13 times in their lifetime. How is that possible? And that was 10 years ago. That was a staggering thought to me. How do you even begin to prepare for that? Jobs and technology that will be available 8 to 10 years from now have not even been thought of yet. But no matter what course in life we have taken or what career we ultimately felt led to pursue, our vocation becomes a big part of who we are, doesn't it? Through our work, we're able to provide for our families. We make a contribution to the world. We find fulfillment and a sense of purpose and accomplishment, and the ability to share our resources with others to do God's work in this world. But as Christ followers, I think it's important for all of us to remember that while our livelihood becomes a big part of who we are, a big part of our identity, it does not define us completely. As believers, we have all been given a calling and a purpose that goes beyond vocation. A high calling, an identity in Christ Jesus our Lord. In writing to the Colossians, the Apostle Paul reminds them that no matter what it is that they do, they are to do it all in the name of Christ Jesus and for God's glory. In essence, what Paul is saying is no matter what our hands find to do in this life, Christ calls us to do it all as unto the Lord. Well, what did Paul mean by that? What is it? How are we supposed to do that? How can we make our secular work a service unto the Lord? Well, I think Paul gives us the answer in his letter to the Galatians, where he writes these words: I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ who lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we have the opportunity, we have the invitation to consecrate ourselves, all that we are, our work, no matter what it is, to Christ each and every day, as we die to ourselves and live for Christ, doing all and everything as unto the Lord. We have the opportunity to shine the light of Christ and to show the love of Christ to those with whom we serve, to those with whom we work, no matter where we are or what we are doing. when we show compassion and understanding to those around us, when we see Christ in them and allow Christ to be seen in us, when we remember that whatever our work may be, whatever job we do, that our calling as believers is to be ambassadors for Christ. Our work, wherever we may find ourselves, our work as believers is to be ambassadors for Christ, because our true identity is found in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Christian author and pastor Tim Keller was interviewed some years ago on MSNBC's Morning Joe show, and he was talking about the identity that we have in Christ our Lord versus the vocational label or the job label that we might wear by virtue of our work. And he said this: when you make your work your identity, if you are successful, then it can sometimes go to your head because you think it's all about you. And if you are not successful, then it can crush you because it goes to your heart. It can destroy your self-worth. But our faith in Christ gives us an identity that is not tied to our work or tied to our accomplishments, an identity that is not tied to our successes or our failures, but an identity that is grounded in who Christ is and the loving and the grace-filled work that God in Christ has done for each one of us. Our work should be our servant, not our Lord. Obviously, most of us in this life have to work in order to survive, to provide food and shelter and the necessities of life for ourselves and for our families. In John chapter 6, Jesus tells his disciples to work not only for earthly food that will pass away, but food that will last forever. Now, Jesus' friends, as was so often the case, didn't really understand all that Jesus meant by what he was saying, because they were looking at life, as we often do, through earthly eyes. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." So in all your toiling, in all your labor here on this earth for things that will pass away, don't miss out on the things that are eternal, Jesus is saying. Those things that will never pass away. "For I am the bread of life," Jesus says. "Believe in me, and your hungry souls will be nourished. Believe in me, and you will be filled to overflowing." You know, we spend our lives, don't we, making a living in order to put bread on our tables. But when we come to the table of the Lord, we come to receive God's gift of grace offered to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's a gift that money cannot buy. It's a gift that wages cannot earn. A work that has been done for us that we cannot do for ourselves. A love that extends to us and invites us to respond in faith. So as we come today, let us come remembering the work of love that God in Christ has done for us, and for all the world. Let us come with joy for this labor of love that Christ has accomplished for us and for all the world, the work of forgiveness that Christ has done for you and for me. We receive God's grace when we eat the bread of life and when we drink together the cup of salvation. And it is also here at this table that we are filled, that we are sustained, that we are nourished for the labors of love to which Christ has called us. Because our identity in Christ, all of our work, all of our labors can be done in the name of Jesus and for God's glory, as Christ lives in us and through us. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O blessed Lord, we give you thanks for the work of our hands, for all the blessings that you bestow upon us through our labors. And as we prepare our hearts to once again receive your gifts of grace to us, remind us that the gift of salvation through Christ Jesus our Lord comes to us not by our own doing, not through any work that we can do or have done, but because of what Christ our Lord has done for us. You extend the invitation. You have provided the food for this table. And you invite us to respond in faith. So open our hearts and our minds to receive your grace, to be fed and sustained for all the labors of love to which you call us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. It is through the work of our hands that God enables us to give back a portion with which God has blessed us. So I invite our ushers to come now to receive God's tithes and our offerings. Thank you.
minds and bodies that are able to labor and to serve, and for the abundance of your gifts to us. All that we have comes from you. Make us to be channels of your good gifts to others, so that as our blessings increase, so may our faithfulness in giving unto you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite us now to turn to page 12 in our hymnals as we prepare for the service of Holy Communion.
Healed the sick, he fed the hungry,
his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and to reign with you at your right hand. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he gave it to you, and he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. So now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together as our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. So now, with joy for all that God in Christ has done for us, let us come and receive God's good gifts to us. Let us stand together and sing, and we will sing verses 1, 3, and 4 of R.E. Abel. God the Holy Spirit, to all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.